Okay, so thank you for inviting me, giving this seminar. My name is Clotilde Cucinotta, and yes, I work at Imperial College London. And I will talk about how to improve the design of electrochemical devices with theory and modeling. So in this talk, I will illustrate some examples of what can be achieved with theory and modeling, some of the issues that we have and some suggestions about how to overcome these issues. And I will start by illustrating the general application field that I have in mind. So you see here represented many different devices for energy. You have water splitting devices, batteries, fuel cells, but also devices for nanotechnologies, sort of such as memristors, electrochemical gating devices, and biological processes, which is such as neurotransmission or corrosion process, which is very common. So what all these processes and devices have in common is that essentially they are all electrochemical processes and devices. So this means that these processes are essentially work thanks to the same operating principle, so which is the combined effect of chemical transformation, applied potential and currents. The interesting part is that these processes or important component of element of component of this process occur at the nanoscale. So if we want to improve the description of these devices or control these processes, we need to understand how these processes occur at the nanoscale, at tiny interfaces between different materials. And so the importance of the nanoscale was already highlighted by Feynman in 1959, which says that there is plenty of room at the bottom, so paving effectively the way for nanotechnologies. And so to illustrate the importance of this nanoscale, I would start from an example of a device, let's say the artificial leaf. This device, which makes possible to produce hydrogen under exposure of the device to water, to the sun from water. So the problem is that after more than 200 years after water was split for the first time, we still are not able to achieve an efficiency in this device, in this water artificial leaf, which is appealing for commercial applications, and so still proceed by trial and error. On the other hand, we would need, if we had the ability to have a lens on the microscopic atomistic processes underlying this hydrogen production, we could develop targeted approach to improve the devices. And for these experiments are a bit problematic because sometimes it's difficult to achieve such resolution with experimental techniques. And therefore, theory and simulation is essential. But the problem is that actually we have issues with having a comprehensive theory at the nanoscale to model these phenomena. And this is precisely what is that I typically work on, developing applications and new methodologies to address how to model these phenomena in my group. So let's try to illustrate a little bit what happens and why these phenomena are a bit difficult to simulate, and in general what they are. So electrochemical phenomena occur, are combined phenomena where there is an electrical and a chemical component. So we have currents, electron currents going in and out of the cell, and these currents sustain complex electron transfer reaction, interfacial reaction, which transforms species into other species. So in order to simulate electrochemical transformation, we need to be able to simulate these electrical and chemical phenomena in combination. But actually, current methodologies can only are only able to focus on single component on this, and there is a problem in combining the two. So to go a bit more in deep in what in this problem, let's think of what happens, let's say, during electron transfer reaction, let's say hydrogen evolution, there is a reduction where an electron is given to the species in solution. So what happens in this case is that this level would like to go down, but of course there is a battery attached to this system, to this electrode, and therefore electron which is missing is essentially recovered, and this level is kept constant. So that this is what happens during experiment during electrochemical transformation at a constant potential. However, what we have in theory, when we model atomistically these kind of processes using traditional methodologies, we see that applying these traditional methodologies to the simulation of the electrochemical transformation is a bit problematic, because when we use, let's say, DFT in its standard implementation, use a canonical environment where the number of electrons and atoms it's fixed. And therefore, we are not able to change the number of electrons in the electrode or to keep it constant during electrochemical transformation. So what happens is that this level will go down while we simulate electrode polarization or electron transfer reactions. And so we see that even if we have this fundamental limitation, this intrinsic limitation of standard methodologies to simulate systems, electrochemical systems, which are characterized by this additional parameter, which is the electrochemical potential. And yet, a very nice thing have been modeled using just adapting traditional methodologies to model the electrochemical environment. And of course, these are the cost in terms of realism of the description of the charge distribution at the interface, or even more of the realism of the distribution of reaction pathways which lead to electron transfer, which describe electron transfer reaction. And on the other hand, it is not fully true that standard methodologies are not able to describe systems where current can flow in and out of the system. There is a molecular electronic community which does this in a standard way. And for instance, this is an example of what they've done some years ago already. It's about modeling electron tunneling using electrochemical nanojunctions, okay, and proving that coherent approach, transport approach is able to describe the tunneling barrier in this system. However, the problem in these methodologies is that even if we are able to take into to describe everything in terms of the non-equilibrium green function in the region where the electron transfer occur, typically we are not able to study the effect of these fields or currents on atomic movements which occur within electrochemical junctions or in general between the electrodes. And so we see that essentially there is a gap at the interface between these two fields, which is the ability to model chemical and electrical processes in combination, okay, to model and in particular electrochemical phenomena which require both. And this is the focus of what we do in my group, which is essentially, I work essentially, my sort of philosophy is to progress towards improving the description of electrochemical phenomena using in parallel two approaches. On the one hand, trying to have a more realistic representation of electrochemical processes in operation, for instance, overcoming the traditional surface science approaches where electrode activity is described simply in terms of the electrode ability to absorb molecules in gas phase and to introduce the complexity of the dynamics of the interactions in the solvent, which has been proven more than once that determine how the activity of the electrode in operando condition. And the other line is to try to develop new methodologies, integrated methodologies, which make possible to simulate this environment in the correct way, which means giving the possibility to the electrons to go away into the reservoir and to see what is the effect of currents, of electric field to the atomic movement, which is a simplified way to say reaction, for instance, in this in electrochemical systems. And so we apply these methodologies to solve a variety of different electrochemical problems, ranging from electrochemical gating in anode junction to study study spillover of the metal the change of resistance, I would say, of in electrochemical metallization memories, but also the interest in understanding fundamental catalytic phenomena at interfaces, starting from the ranging from understanding intercalation of sodium in sodium ion batteries and water splitting at the platinum water interface. Then there are also side projects. I just want to mention, since I'm here, I have a research line going on in 2D materials and studying environmental stability, chemical reactivity, and catalytic activity of this class, very interesting class of materials, and also applying enhanced sampling methodologies to model phase transition in a particular electrochemical system, which is ionic liquid. But of course, I won't have the time to illustrate this. I might have the time to give one slide about what is the way we pursue and we are developing to interface electron transport, non-equilibrium green function methodologies and chemical reactivity. But what I want to focus on in the following is just to understand a bit more about modeling electrified interface, in particular the most fundamental electrified interface, platinum water, in a realistic way and under the application identification of a potential. And it is amazing how little we know about this interface, even if it is so important and so fundamental. So let's start from what we want to model. Essentially, we need to, first of all, to define, to understand this this concept of double layer. Okay, when we have a liquid and a metal, but in general, whenever we have two different materials that get together, of course, there is an accumulation of charges of different sign, which accumulate at the opposite side of the interface because you break the symmetry. And so this generates, especially in electrochemical systems, this generates electric field at the interface, which are huge and fluctuating. And within this electric field, electrochemical transformation occur. And on top of this, we apply a potential to the electrode, which actually define the structure of this interface and the potential drop across the interface. So essentially, we want to know what is the atomic structure, what are the interactions which occur at this interface, because this is the atomistic information that we need to understand how water material is split, let's say, at the metal-water interface and produce hydrogen or oxygen. And however, the problem is that the typical models that we still use at the time are have been developed like more than 200 years ago, and they are still, of course, very useful to interpret phenomena, but we want to go more in deep now. We want to have a description of what happens at the atomistic level. And so we are back at the atomistic with our structure of that I've shown before about the electrolytic cell. And then we say that we have already a problem which is associated with the ability to keep the potential constant during transformation and electrode polarization because we use a fixed number of electrons. But the problem that we have when we want to model this interface in particular with an applied potential is also that we typically use periodic boundary conditions in our simulations. And I think you all know what periodic boundary conditions are. The system is replicated in all directions. So the problem with this approach of using a canonical environment with periodic boundary conditions is that the system Fermi level wants to be, will be constant across the system. So it's difficult to apply a potential drop across, let's say, these two electrodes. And because in the self-consistent filling of the levels, of the DFT levels, if we use DFT, the electron will go back from one electron to the one electrode to the other, so that the Fermi level can be constant across the interface. And so this is a big problem when we want to simulate an electric cell, electrolytic cell. However, I mean, still, I mean, as I said, as I anticipated before, there are different approaches which make possible to address, to try to mitigate the two main issues, a fixed number of electrons and a fixed Fermi level and periodic boundary conditions. And the fact is that actually we are not interested in modeling the full cell. First of all, we are typically interested in modeling a half cell. Okay, and then maybe we can find the solution, an alternative solution, which is a very the typically adopted solution by this community. Instead of applying a potential to the electrode, to the electrodes, and to have a different potential at the two electrodes, is to simulate half cell and try to charge in some way the electrode. So in a way that the potential drop between the electrode and the bulk, the potential drop across, close to the electrode, is realistic. Of course, indeed, these approaches one need to be careful because even if this is the common idea, then it's a bit difficult to achieve a realistic potential drop across the interface in a realistic charge distribution and a realistic distribution of the electric field at the interface. And so the solution that I've proposed in this case is first of all, try to address the problem of the constancy of the Fermi level, just increasing the dimension of the electrode so that at least during polarization, the Fermi level doesn't change much. And the other idea is essentially mutated by chemistry, essentially. So when you want to reduce, let's say, a nanotube in chemistry, you just add ammonium ions in the solution, and there is a charge transfer between the ion and the electrode, which charges the electrode. So the same idea I wanted to implement here. And so I developed a system where water in contact with this platinum electrode is described explicitly fully from first principles. So this is a system that has been studied fully from first principles with explicit ions in solution. So the trick to charge, and so we see that in this way, if this is the potential, electrostatic potential across my periodic cell, if this potential is flat in these two regions, and in this region I'm able to simulate bulk water, actually I have a realistic representation of the potential drop at the interface. How do I change the charge on the electrode? I just vary the concentration of anions and cations in solution. So the idea is, let's say that I introduce an excess of chlorine atoms in solution, a slight excess, so that I can still consider the molarity of my water solution almost constant. What happens is that, let's say I add the two chlorine atoms in solution, they want to leave in solution as negative ions, and therefore they will take some charge from the electrode. And so if you use three different concentrations, let's say 12 chlorine atoms and 10 sodium atoms, 10 sodium atoms and 10 chlorine atoms, and 10 chlorine atoms and 12 sodium atoms, you will achieve two, three different concentration, the charge state of your electrode with three potential drop, which can be compared. And so this is all about, this is with this methodology, actually we could progress beyond what was the state of the art before this, and find, I mean, I don't know if it progressed, but anyway, to find very, very interesting results. Okay, I think I will skip this. This is just a reflection about the fact that in order for this to be true, let's say for chlorine, I have mentioned, there must be the highest occupied level of the chlorine must be below Fermi level, and the first empty level of chlorine must be below Fermi level so that an electron can naturally transfer towards this atom. So I will illustrate this more in detail if there will be the need. Anyway, with this approach, it was possible to understand a lot of things about this interface and about the structure of the water in contact with the interface. So you see what I plotted here is the same thing as here, but I prefer this because it's a bit more pictorial. And essentially what one of the things that we figured out is that when you change the state of potential of your electrode, which means the state of charge of your electrode, you have this special situation where the number of water molecules which are in contact with the surface change Okay, and so it's interesting because if we want to then do the next step where we want to study, when we want to study hydrogen or oxygen evolution as a function of the potential, we see that we need the water network changes. So we need to take into account this. And I believe that that was not highlighted before. I mean, there are several models for what is the structure of the water at the interface with the, an electrode, but never we saw how this water this structure was affected when we apply a potential. And this is another example. Also another example is how more detail about the charge distribution at this interface, electric charge distribution, which is oscillating. And also we could extract capacitance just plotting potential drop versus charge, and also aligning this to an absolute, this trend to an absolute scale of potential, just using the potential of zero charge to align it to the standard electrode potential scale. Yes, other information is about the lateral structure of water on top of the surface, as well as we are now progressing towards understanding coverage of hydrogen atoms of these surfaces. And we did realize that actually also this common knowledge that hydrogen absorbed on a surface are equidistant. Actually, it's not true. We saw that hydrogen can cluster together and form domains which have a different nature, can be an FCC site or in top sites, and these domains change. So, and as a function of a concentration of the atoms on the surface, as well as of the potential state of the system. And this, of course, has the effect that the water layer above it is affected, that we have three specific interfaces, even when we have sort of at least two, when we have a fully covered hydrogen surface, where there is some region which is empty and some region which is FCC, let's say in the case of the one monolayer. If you go a bit down in coverage, to get also the FCC domain. So we see that if we improve extend the current simulation method to a realistic representation of what happens with ab initio molecular dynamics, studying dynamically what happens and trying to reproduce realistically this interface, we can improve the description and understand a lot of things. But of course, always forcing methodologies which are not natural for this environment to model this environment, because there is this intrinsic limitation that the number of electrons in the electrode cannot change. So the idea that we are developing now, there is a UAU. UAU. Then is a new postdoc started recently, joined the group, is to essentially using the methodologies of molecular electronics, which makes possible to expand and express everything in terms of the non-equilibrium density of the region between the electrodes, and to use this non-equilibrium density, and which is obtained in terms of non-equilibrium Green functions and typical molecular electronic approaches, to use this non-equilibrium density to calculate forces. And so forces calculated in this way would embed the information that electrons go in and out of the system, and that there is, let's say, a potential drop, there is an electric field between the two electrodes. And so it will be possible in this way to calculate structure or chemical transformation in the presence of current flowing. So see what the current, how the currents affect this chemical transformation, and sending the electrons to the right reservoir. We can make an example, the example of a battery, of an electrode in a battery, and we know that if we pass a current, this electrode expands. Okay, with this we can calculate the stress tensor and its dependence on the current, and we can see what is the tendency in this terms, in this sense of the system, if it wants to expand, to model this process, which is a very high technological importance with this methodology. So in general, would it be possible to simulate energy and nanodevice in operation? And we have some examples of these. Okay, one example was this, we had this hydrogen molecule sandwiched between two gold electrodes, and we saw that when we pass a current through the system, the phonon modes of the hydrogen molecule change in an obvious way. Or this is something that we are also doing, try to understand, we have a silver wire, and in this silver wire we pass a current, and so this silver wire tend to shrink, and therefore the Young modulus of the wire changes, and this is observed experimentally. So this is just some toy applications of preliminary implementation of our methodology. And okay, that's it. So essentially developing methodologies which combine electrochemistry, computational electrochemistry, and molecular electronics helps to progress towards bridging the gap between theory, experiment, and technological applications, and develop them in the best in a more informed way. And that's it. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you for such an enlightening talk, Clotilde. We don't have any questions at the moment, but if anybody does have a question, if you'd like to unmute and ask away.
Yeah, so Clotilde, it's Alex. I just wanted to ask a couple of things. So you didn't mention anything about pH, I think, or I couldn't hear.
No, I didn't, because of course that is an additional problem in electrochemical simulation. We have the problem of the pH. And I can tell you that there is a problem actually for the pH. I show you something, because I told you that we studied, sorry, this is not a polished slide because I decided not to present this eventually, but the problem of pH is serious, because this is a simulation of hydrogen covered electrode, the dynamical simulation, okay? Now, I mean, it's very fast, but I want you to focus on these hydrogen here, which are attached here in solution, okay? So, on the electrode, and what happens to this hydrogen during the simulation? So, what happens is that after a while, this hydrogen dissolves, okay? You can see here, you see? So when you do a simulation to study absorption of hydrogen on a surface, you can't simply use the surface approach that you add the hydrogen on the surface and that's it, and then you calculate the formation, the absorption energy using some meaningful reference, because the electrode potential state changes during the simulation, because the system wants to minimize its free energy. Tuning the potential of the electrode, but also changing the pH of the solution. So this is a huge problem. Of course, I could tell you that one can model, there are different methodologies to model the pH of a solution. You can include one H plus ion in solution. You can change the, you can introduce ions and see what is the local effect of that charged ion on the specific process that you have. Or you can use the method that Alan Norskov, where you essentially use the next equation, you shift the energy by 2.3 kT pH of the system. But actually, when you want to really simulate the thing and you want to have a realistic representation of what is going on, you get a lot of issues that we are trying to work on at the moment. I can tell you this.
Okay, yeah, thanks a lot. So another question is concerning, how material can penetrate through electrodes. So for example, electrodes may be polycrystalline, have some grain boundaries. Water can go in, various things may happen, including hydrogen itself, which hydrogen may dissolve in, platinum or something. So do you take that into account? And so what happens to charge state of these species?
Of course, we need to, we all know that when we model systems ab initio and we have limited computational resources and not in an infinite time, an essential component is to model the system, a system which is representative, even if maybe a simplification of the problem that you want to simulate. So I expect that even if we are developing a combination of methodologies at the moment, and you can unsample methodologies to simulate what happens at this interface, unless you pump energy on the specific degree of freedom, it's difficult that you will observe in the time of the simulation, even with an unsampled methodologies, these processes. That said, I've submitted a project. If it is successful, this January, I would start studying the effect of low coordination site, the catalytic activity of low coordination site in platinum nanocluster or let's say surfaces. Because of course, what happens there is very different from what happens to the plane surface. So studying what happens at the NAGE, the difference in the propensity to absorb and possibly to displace also at that point, because in that way would in that configuration that model would be easier to achieve that of hydrogen or hydroxyl group at that interface as a function of the potential. Of course, that would go in the direction that that you mentioned. Yes, but I haven't studied specifically. Absorption and insertion of the hydrogen, which I know. I mean, there are sometimes sub-layer, sub-bubbles of hydrogen underneath the surface. This is maybe explained also why in operando surface science is very difficult. I mean, it gives a completely different result than the standard, the classical surface science. If we analyze the current results, but even simple psychovoltammogram, we see things that are a bit different. If we control a little bit the surface, that are a bit different from what the standard theory tells. And so we need to be open to be able to model these processes.
Yeah, thanks very much. Yeah, thanks, Ojo.
Thanks.
Jochen, you have a question. If you'd like to unmute.
Oh, hello. I was just the end. I was a bit puzzled because you basically seemed to be talking about two different things. At the beginning, it's a typical electron transfer / electrochemistry, where an electron goes from a solvated species to probably to an electrode or something like that. At the end, then you were talking about transport from one electrode to another via a molecule. So these are two very different things. So this non-equilibrium Green's function method is you know, the state-of-the-art method for the latter kind of thing, where you really look through currents going through a molecule. Whereas electrochemistry is a very fundamentally different process, you know, where you have an ET basically going from a molecular species to an electrode, and also the mechanism is very different, sort of incoherent, because actually the charge actually lives obviously on the redox species, whereas in the transport through a molecule it doesn't really. I was just, you know, these are sort of two different worlds, I think, in that.
But yet I think there is something in common between the two worlds. to answer you, of course, when you have an electrochemical system, I don't assume that I will study the in a system like this with a great with an insulator between the two electrodes. I don't think that studying electron tunneling in a coherent fashion between the two electrodes would be relevant. Of course, it's not. But in the stationary, when the electrons are on the electrode, they can, if you use this formalism, you can send them to the correct reservoir, because in the assumption, which I think applies in electrochemistry, that the transfer from the electrode to the reservoir is fast with respect to what can happen at the interface. Of course, you can't use simply electron transport methodologies for this. You can use this to give the boundary conditions to this problem, the correct boundary conditions to the problem, but then you still need to calculate forces and to study how these complex electron transfer processes occur. On the point that the transport is always incoherent. It depends on the size of the junction. For instance, we are starting with Margherita studying electrochemical, electrochemical nanojunction. So when the nanojunction is of the order of nanometers, it can be interesting to see and to compare different regimes using master equations if one wants to model incoherent transport, or simply also stay in the Landauer limit or just on the limit of the coherent transport, and see what happens to the system. Because here we have also an additional problem. We have an additional element here. We have a junction where there is a non-negligible current flowing through the system. So if the current flow through the system, first of all, if you apply, if you are able to change the chemical potential of the electrode, you are able to study elementary absorption processes at the electrode and how possible transmission channels open in the presence of a structure which is not the standard structure. And on top of this, you have a current flowing through the system, which might affect the way atoms and molecules interact with the solvent and to each other. And the last thing is that, we don't need to underestimate the importance of this current-induced effect. Also in electrodes which are planar, because we know from studying of electrochemical metallization memories that even in planar surfaces, there is the formation, or even in batteries, let's say, there is this dendritic growth. And I believe that once you start creating a filament, if a current flow through the filament, the ability of this or wants to flow through the filament, and the ability for this filament to grow can be affected. And because in general we are very far from in all our system, real system, from studying ideal planar surfaces. Mm-hmm. Of course, the validity of the non-equilibrium Green function formalism to study this kind of phenomena needs to be assessed, of course. I agree, but I don't agree with the fact that it's not useful in these limits.
No, I didn't say this at all. I was just to make the link, but
clear this distinction. Sorry, what did you say? Sorry, because I have a slow response.
I didn't mean to say that it's not useful. It was just hard for me in my my mind to make the connection. But yeah, maybe we can talk about it another time again.
I think so. I think there is indeed, I am very interested in what you do. And I think there is a lot to understand from you. And I would like to talk to you indeed.
Okay, great. Well, I hope the lockdown is over soon.
Sorry.
Okay. Yeah, thanks, Clotilde.